Our focus today is on accepting God's call, our commitment, 2 Timothy 2:2. Accepting God's call requires our commitment to be responsible to the charge that we have received. In 2 Timothy 2:2, the King James Version says, "And the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also." The New King James Version says, "The things which you have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, commit these to faithful men who will be able to teach others also." The Apostle Paul told Timothy to entrust and deposit everything that he taught him to faithful men or human beings, both men and women, who will be able to teach and direct others also. Who does the entrusting? God has entrusted your pastor as your teacher. He was taught by the late, great Bishop P.L. Scott, who entrusted and deposited teaching into his life. Now he is entrusting it to others. According to 1 Corinthians 4:15, in the New International Version, even if you had 10,000 guardians in Christ, you do not have many fathers. For in Christ Jesus, I became your father through the gospel. Your pastor will give you the charge through the laying on of hands. He will be one of many teachers alongside your organizational leaders, meaning diocesan, chairman, or other leaders, Sunday school teacher, college professors, minister class teacher, Bible class teacher, small group leader, and your mentor. These are all your teachers, but you only have one father that begot you through the gospel. They know you best because they watch your lifestyle, character, and will deem you trustworthy and faithful. They will see the change and the growth in your life, the spiritual maturity and eagerness to learn, grow, develop, and move forward in the work of the Lord. Your pastor will commit and deposit the Word of God into your life and spirit. And guess what? They expect you to commit their sayings and teachings to other people. Remember, God has called, empowered, and equipped you to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. Don't embarrass your leaders or make them ashamed. As you preach, make sure that you use proper hermeneutics and homiletics. So, what is homiletics? Let's review our scriptural text because we define homiletics through it. In 2 Timothy 4, verses 1 through 2, the King James Version, the Apostle Paul told Timothy, "I charge thee, therefore, before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. Preach the word. Be instant in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, and exhort with all long-suffering and doctrine." Also in 1 Timothy 4:13, the King James Version, the Apostle Paul told Timothy, "Till I come, give attendance to reading, to exhortation, and to doctrine." Thus, the biblical concept of preaching is centered on four words. In the Old Testament, the words neba means to prophesy, and it is used 110 times in the Old Testament. The word katangelo means to proclaim, declare, or announce, and it is used 60 times in the New Testament. Euangelion means to declare the good news, and it appears 50 times in the New Testament. Thus, homiletics, or a sermon, is the art and science of preaching, and hermeneutics is the science of interpretation. Let me say it this way. Hermeneutics should come before homiletics. Hermeneutics requires you to exegete and interpret the scripture, and homiletics is the composition, application of scripture, and delivery of sermon. According to our authors, Dr. Gibson and Dr. Kim, every preacher preaches out of an articulated or unarticulated perspective. The perspective might be methodical, theoretical, philosophical, cultural, sociological, or theological. Our text explains why our parishioners may not always understand the different preacher style of preaching because of their delivery using a methodical, theoretical, philosophical, cultural, social, or a theological approach. The book focuses on the theological presuppositions of approaches and the hermeneutics that lies behind preaching. Many of their presuppositions are based on the four major types of biblical hermeneutics that include the literal, moral, allegorical, and anagogical methods of interpretation. It uses these methods and biblical exegesis to formulate and make assumptions beforehand at the beginning of their line of argument and course of action. It is requiring one to draw out the meaning of the text based on an investigation of the language, history, culture, and context of a passage in its original setting. Many preachers get into trouble when they use eisegesis. So what is eisegesis? Exegesis tries to listen to the text and let the meaning come from the text itself in its original historical context. It also allows one to explain or provide an exposition of the text based on a careful, objective analysis. Remember, the word exegesis literally means to lead out of. That means that the interpreter is led to his conclusions by following the text, line upon line, precept on precept. Eisegesis brings the meaning to the text and does not concern itself with the original historical context of a biblical passage. Eisegesis, on the other hand, reads into the text what the interpreter wishes to find or thinks he finds there. It expresses the reader's own subjective ideas, not the meaning which is in the text. Now, in some religious circles, eisegesis is frowned upon. But according to our author, Dr. Anderson, the preacher and teacher's job is to help people hear from God. That means translating the message into languages and forms that the listener can hear. The primary concern is that the people hear from the word of God that is preached and taught to them. Therefore, an exegetical method would use a modern understanding of those terms in a religious context to understand what the passage means. So as we move ahead through this learning journey, we will explore all four of these concepts more in depth.